Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, I want to dedicate this little comment section that I have to my sister Virginia in Michigan. Now, here's why. I was watching, or we as a group were watching, a video of Sergio and Rhoda, and they were doing a section on harvesting the olives in Israel. And I was thinking of my sister, where she lives, they have cherry trees. And the cherry trees are very similar to the olive trees, although cherries are much more tender, but they're not good to eat. You don't want to eat them right away because they're sour cherries. Okay. And my sister drives this machine that goes up and it grabs the tree with a big padded claw. And so, well, and then sets a huge canvas underneath the tree. Then shakes the whole thing, and there's a rain of cherries come down. And they're all picked up and away they go. And she does that, and she's pretty valuable to my brother-in-law, cousin, who actually owns and runs the orchard, because she can harvest a tree in a minute.
Wow.
1 minute. She's in there, climb, shake, gone. Okay, why is that important? Well, it's important for another reason, because it occurred to me, when the Lord comes, he's going to grab the earth, he's going to shake it, and all the dead pop out of the graves. And we who are alive and remain will be prepared, transformed, ready for transport to wherever we're going to be going, and we'll find that all out. And I said, you know, that's pretty neat. And it will all be done in under a minute. Okay, it's going to be like, whoa, that was quick.
Wow.
Anyway, that was near Traverse City.
Oh, what a beautiful section of Michigan.
Yeah. I grew up there, so I was kind of jaded. I didn't realize how good I had it until I moved to New York.
Rockies by the lake.
Oh, really?
Yes. It's like beautiful.
Yeah. Even have a little ski area.
But overcast.
For winter, huh?
Oh, yeah.
But overcast.
No, you're thinking of...
Rhode Island.
Yeah, Rhode Island or Binghamton, New York is like that. Okay. You know, they're all shocked when the sun comes out. What's that? No, Travers has got some beautiful thing. I used to have some great times next to the lake. Yeah, that was good. Okay, we're at Psalm 58, a Psalm of David, and it is a prayer for justice. How is it that by remaining silent you can speak righteously? How can you judge people fairly? As a matter of fact, in your heart you plan iniquities. In the land, your hands are violent. The wicked go astray from the womb. They go astray, telling lies even from birth. Their venom is like a poisonous snake, even like a deaf serpent that shuts its ears. Refusing to hear the voice of the snake charmer, the cunning enchanter, God, shatter their teeth and their mouths. Lord, break the fangs of the young lions. May they flow away like rainwater that runs off. May they become like someone who shoots broken arrows. May they be like a snail that dries up as it crawls, like a woman's stillborn baby who never saw the sun. Before your clay pots are placed in the fire of burning thorns, whether green or ablaze, wrath will sweep them away like a storm. I think I know the period of time he's discussing here. Okay? Even though he might not at the time have realized it, this is pointing right at the time when God's wrath is poured out on the world, and we, according to the scriptures, are gone and away from it. The righteous person will rejoice when he sees your vengeance, when he washes his feet in the blood of the wicked. A person will say, certainly the righteous are rewarded. Certainly there is a God who judges the earth. And as Pastor just said, amen to that. I would like to spend some time studying that psalm, just because of the content of it and the portent, prophetic portent. I had some thoughts today about the devilish agenda that's afoot, which has been running for approximately 150 years, maybe more, but it's been running very steadily for about 150 years. And it was a conscription of our money. It was the switching from the gold standard. It was putting people into the thought that socialism is the answer. And it goes on today. In fact, it's gotten much worse. And to me, how can you run something starting with John Dewey back in the 20s, run it for an entire century and not break ranks? You keep marching to the same beat. We've been marching to the same beat right up till today, never changing. How can you do that? Well, I can only think of one logical explanation, and that's that's a demonic-based philosophy, and that Satan is using it to move his plans along. And everywhere it's been tried, it shows his handiwork in heaps of dead bodies, destroyed economies, people suffering. In fact, one of the things that they always say is, oh, don't you care for the poor? Yeah, I care for the poor. I don't want them to die of starvation in Venezuela, or Nicaragua, or Cuba, or any place else where socialism is taken over. And it drives me nuts that people can't see that. They say, oh, socialism is the answer to everything. You know, it gives us free medicine, it gives us free education, it gives us free baloney. Okay. Go look and see what it does in places. Okay. So now I was thinking about Trump. And I came to the conclusion, nobody hates Trump. Like, my goodness, people are full of vitriol. Yes, but I happened to watch a YouTube, I think it was done about 2012, before he really got into anything, and it was on his 737, which he has a private 737 that's fitted out for him to fly around the country and hold conferences and whatnot. They couldn't stop singing his praises. He was the greatest guy. He was fantastic, great to his employees, had great vision, was making everything right. So, okay, what changed? What changed was that the intent all along was to put Hillary Clinton in to finish the work that Barack Obama did and move us way over to the left in the socialist area. And when Trump won, and I don't think Trump won by himself, I think there was divine assistance, touching people's hearts by the millions, and they voted, and he won, and gave us a reprieve. Okay, and I always say, okay, and I just have to ask myself, what would it be like if we were under Hillary right now? What judges would she be putting in place in the Supreme Court? So, yeah, it gets rough. Now, interestingly, I was digging around and I found a comment from the Brookings Institute, which is kind of a lefty place. But even they had to admit, it says, each administration should be judged by what it achieves. At the end of Obama's two terms, Putin had elevated Russia to a credible revisionist power in the international stage. Russia annexed Crimea, occupied eastern Ukraine, and successfully propping up the Assad regime, the Kremlin gained a veto on any possible political solution to Syria and got a meaningful foothold in the region for the first time since Sadat threw Soviet advisors out, and its populist allies and fellow travelers were on the rise in Europe. fueling anti-Americanism and illiberalism, and most damning of all, it managed to meddle unopposed in U.S. politics, all on Obama's watch. Okay, this is the Brigham Institute. They're liberal. They're on the left side. Yet they had to admit it was just too obvious to ignore. And what are they trying to put in? Well, they're trying to put in a one-world government. And what's the shape of the one-world government? We turn to the Bible and we find out. The Lamb opened the third seal. I heard a living creature say, "Come." I looked, and before me was a black horse, and its rider was holding a pair of scales. And I heard a voice that sounded amongst the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a day's wages, 3 quarts of barley for a day's wages, but do not damage the oil and the wine." So, you know, it's poverty. You got to work all day just to have enough for a loaf of bread, basically. People are in desperate poverty. And yet there are people who are doing extremely well. The oil and the wine symbolize living very well. So there are people who are doing great. What does that represent? To me, it represents a socialist undertaking. In Venezuela, where they're having so much trouble, they can't hardly find something to eat, there are people living like kings down there. They are doing wonderful. They're getting all the money from what oil they managed to sell. It's, you know, everybody's equal in a socialist regime, but some people are more equal than others. And that disparity gets to the point of actual threat, life-threatening. Okay, now, the Bible's got a problem, because I found a contradiction in it. Anytime you find a contradiction in the Bible, think about it and dig a little deeper. So I read in Matthew 16:18, "I say unto you that you, Peter, are a rock, and upon this rock I will build my church." He's using Petros, the idea for rock. He's playing a word game. "The gates of hell shall not prevail against it." All right, so nobody's going to prevail against Jesus' church. Revelation 13:7. "It was given unto him," the Antichrist, "to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds, tongues, and nations." How is this possible? It's a direct contradiction, right? What's the problem? Or what's the solution?
Gates are defensive.
Yeah, but who's he talking about in Matthew, and who's he talking about in Revelation? He's talking about the saints of God, which is the church, in Matthew. He's talking about the tribulation saints who've missed the rapture in Revelation. So guess what? That implies to me that before this terrible world comes about in which people are persecuted, we're out of here. We're going to get shaken like that olive tree. And like the olive tree, we're going to get transported to a better place. So just as a encouragement to everybody, just expect that the Lord has it all in his power, and the devil is working really, really hard to subvert it, and he's not going to succeed.
Thank you, Bob.